Hey folks, this is Christian the Ice Age Farmer coming at you with another edition of the Ice Age Farmer podcast. Today is Monday, July 17th, and this is episode 3. I hope you enjoy it. We'll be starting off with some announcements before we review our daily steps towards self-sufficiency, a little daily exercise. Then we'll take a quick look at the news before we get into the main meat of the show. Today, I'd like to share with you a message I received from James Shirley of NASA's JPL. After I inquired directly to him about some of the risks facing us in terms of the human effects of the Grand Solar Minimum. Based on his decades of research, he has somewhat of a different response than I would have imagined he had. We'll take a look at that and I'll share that with you. And that's the rundown. So let's start off with those announcements. Ice Age Farmer is now available on Stitcher as well as iTunes, radio. So if you have friends who are more the pod person than the YouTube watcher, you can now send them the link to Ice Age Farmer and share with them the information about the Grand Solar Minimum and the preparations they need to be taking now to ensure that their family has food security in the times ahead, that we will all be prospering together as we face the challenges coming our way. The links to share are iceagefarmer.com/Stitcher or iceagefarmer.com/iTunes. I've got those rigged up to forward you to the Stitcher or iTunes show pages on there. And then I'll continue to post these shows to YouTube because I do mix in some video content, news, and sometimes videos of whatever I'm talking about or sharing with you. So check that out and pass on those links. All right, that said, let's talk about the steps of the day that we are all taking towards self-sufficiency. Every day we share with each other what we're taking. Let's take a look at what folks were talking about. Wiser was raising and milking some goats yesterday, learning how to make goat cheese, raising chickens for eggs, working on container gardening. He's also fermenting kombucha and some kefir. Little Red Hen also getting hands on moringa, making some salads from broccoli, cabbage, bok choy, cabbage, Brussels sprouts. All of those now, he reminds us, can be started in July. That's a great call out. So those are the vegetables you want to be starting now. I actually have had terrific luck with bok choy, especially in the aquaponics. I actually felt like it was dominating. It was just taking all the nutrients before anything else got a chance to grow. And I'd be totally satisfied with that, except I don't really like it, to be honest. So if I liked bok choy, I would grow tons of it because it grew really easily and dominated my aquaponics beds. Unfortunately, I don't like it. Okay, bananas is growing some butter lettuce, dandelion greens, chives, shaved parsnips, and bee greens, which is another example of the prolific greens that have tubers at the end of the season, the bonus round, like we were mentioning yesterday. I myself have been this past weekend cleaning out the aquaponics systems, so doing the normal routine maintenance on the swirl filter and then sort of looking for gunk in the beds as always. But then I also did a little bit of a deep clean on the tank. I went ahead and took the fish out for a bit, and then while nothing was cycling, I stirred up all the gook from the bottom of the tank and just the solids, got stuff moving, vacuumed it out. Did a partial water change, which so the tank's looking a lot better. I think the fish are going to find it a bit more of a nice living space. But I do have this 10 gallons of aquaponics water, which I tested. It's got great nitrites levels. It's just sitting outside right now. So I need to probably water it down a bit. And then I've got some well-filled fertilized water to do the rounds tonight for the containers. Having some good luck with the compost bin. It's looking great already, which makes me want to find more of those tumblers if I can, or just build some compost bins. But it's getting late in the summer, so that's turning into more of a long-term thing. And then I started designing a greenhouse for here, although I sort of cut that short because I think I'm going to prefer to take a trip to look at properties rather than building up even more here, at least for now. But that's a different conversation altogether. All right, let's dip into the news. Watching on YouTube, there is video for this part. And the links to all the articles I'm mentioning are below in the show notes. Either way. So here, let's begin because, as always, there's just an inordinate amount of news. Tons of extreme weather events, but those are covered pretty broadly, even just on YouTube. So I try not to focus on those and instead focus on those that are hints or can indicate something about the times ahead that will help us brace for them and make sure that we are doing everything we can to be maximally secure. So although it is worth mentioning that even here in the Northern Hemisphere, you know, we're seeing Moscow sustaining heavy flooding again. Similarly, flooding is hitting Arizona, where it was just ridiculously hot only a couple weeks ago. China, also another case of severe flooding and record rains there. These are the positive lightning that's getting crazy. Four family members, four people in Uganda, all killed by a single strike of lightning, and 50 goats in China. I mean, these are, a single strike kills the entire herd. This is not normal lightning strikes. These are positive lightning, and you can recognize them because they look so, they're freak strikes. They're not like normal lightning strikes. They have these kinds of effects. Remember the reindeer, these kinds of things. And you can tell that these events are picking up. But I'm skirting over these because what I really want to bring to our attention here is the severity of the winter that is actively striking the southern hemisphere right now. So we had definitely a more interesting winter than usual this past, and we're seeing extreme and out of season events. But right now it is winter in the southern hemisphere, and Santiago, Chile just got, for the first time in 20 years, a ton of snowfall. These extremely low temperatures, although Chile wasn't record lows elsewhere, Argentina did hit record lows. It was like negative 21, so 21 degrees below zero Celsius there. And while these things are happening, while these extremely dangerous extreme temperatures are happening, you know, obviously we need heat to get, as a human, to get through that. The power outages are just are overwhelming us. So 330,000 people in Santiago happened while that snowstorm is hitting. This is a recipe for, I mean, this is a disaster. It's not a good thing. And the frequency of these sorts of things is increasing. And so it doesn't have to be a, you know, it's just imagining these sorts of things continuing to happen with greater frequency does constitute, you know, the call it the black swan, or the hay that breaks the camel's back. Australia, also in the southern hemisphere, also being hit with record cold and logistical issues down there caused by those colds. And so, as I mentioned, the reason that I'm bringing these things up here is that we're going to be having, also, winter started, you know, 5-6 weeks early in the southern hemisphere this past, just a few weeks ago. So I would expect that we will be seeing in the northern hemisphere as well that winter arrives early, and it arrives with some ferocity. This is not boding well. The other thing I wanted to bring attention to, I love how they put an irrelevant video here. Fox News did a secondary coverage of the NASA announcement that we're entering a solar minimum. I've mentioned this a few times on my channel already because I think it's important that we see the establishment re-announcing a solar minimum and not qualifying it as a grand one. So it's basically, as I've called out, a modified limited hangout, where you take just a bit of the truth and hang it out there, you modify it a bit so people don't really know what's going on, but you inoculate people against the truth. This is a different play, okay? If all of the media had been doing that, then I sort of would have stuck to that. But what I see here in Fox's coverage is that they do go beyond the 11-year cycle and mention the grand max and the grand minimum every 100 to 200 years. What would happen? They even mention the monitor minimum. It's almost as if, in fact, folks, what's happening here is that they are desperately trying to politicize the grand solar minimum. If they can take these cycles of solar activity and turn it into an argument like global warming, where people on the left side of the aisle say that this is just normal sun activity, and people on the right side of the aisle say that no, this is actually a grand cycle, these are heading into a grand minimum, then they will have successfully divided and conquered us. And so I wanted to very specifically call this out, that it looks like it's so hard to even talk about politics with a straight face anymore, but the quote-unquote conservative media, Fox News, is acknowledging the grand solar minimum. Whereas if you look at just the NASA PR and the CNN and WAPO and that kind of nonsense covering it, it's just, oh, the sun might be behaving a little bit weird, but it's just this normal 11-year sun cycles and everything is fine. And so they are they're splitting the population into the reality based and the, I mean, they're further splitting. And I got to try really hard not to even speak to that liberal versus conservative divide, because see, or they're succeeding, right? Or I've fallen into the trap, because what we're doing here is speaking to the very real science of a grand solar minimum, the solar cycles that dictated, and the results, the human results of those minima here on Earth. And if we start talking about whether or not global warming is real, or if it's the liberals that don't believe in the sun cycle, you know, we've lost the battle. We've lost that battle. So I'm calling that out here so that we don't fall down that trap and we don't start thinking liberals don't know about the sun or whatever the case may be. We can't let this become a red versus blue kind of a nonsense divide and conquer thing. We need to stick to the science and what is happening and what has happened in the past. And as a result, very clearly what we need to be doing now and preparing for the future. Only a few days ago, I wrote a message to James Shirley after doing the video on the grand solar minimum science, sort of exploring the literature, including his work. I was actually so impressed with his work that I went ahead and reached out to him through this extremely generic looking form on JPL's website, on NASA's site. We'll go ahead and read what I asked him. Greetings, Mr. Shirley. I have been investigating the body of evidence that suggests we're entering a prolonged solar minimum, including your work, as well as the history of the human effects of previous minima. The situation suggests we should be concerned about our current agricultural systems and transitively our economy and probably much more. I'm very interested in your perspective on the modern human effects we might endure from the changes in solar activity. Are I and others wrong to share these concerns? It doesn't seem that you afford many interviews, but I would very much appreciate just a few minutes of your time, whether by phone or even email, to assuage the fears of a growing part of the public and myself. Many thanks for the dedication to and integrity in your years of remarkable research. All right. And that was able to answer, somewhat to my surprise. Mr. Shirley responded, thanks for your message and your kind words. I believe that a concern for the future course of weather and climate is healthy and valid. My time is overcommitted, and at this time I cannot begin any form of dialogue on these topics. However, leave it to a scientist to respond with a paper. However, I am sending a fairly recent paper by Nicola Scafetta that I think is very valuable for understanding the situation. I believe that his projections for the future changes of global mean temperatures are the best available at present. The contribution of constraining the sensitivity of the climate system is an important one. One must recognize that the human disasters of the Little Ice Age may not be similarly repeated in the modern world, where transportation can greatly alleviate localized failures of agricultural systems. Thus, I am hopeful. And I have thoughts on that, but I'll finish his note first. Please note that Dr. Scafetta has been labeled a climate denier, which I believe is inaccurate and unfair. He and I are not in agreement on physical causes so far. Nonetheless, I am fairly confident that he has gotten it right in the attached. Best regards, Jim Shirley. So first, I just want to say props to him. Thanks, Mr. Shirley, for actually responding to a member of the public, a citizen scientist, whatever we want to call ourselves these days. I think this is actually admirable that he actually responds, and I really appreciate that, and I want to call that out. It's great. The first point he made is in his first paragraph is stressing the importance of constraining the sensitivity of the climate system. He then goes on to say that it might not look like the last Little Ice Age, because this time we have transportation systems and technology and we can sort of alleviate the localized failures. I am not as confident in our modern day just-in-time delivery systems. I am well familiar with its with how fragile it is, and how at the sign, even it didn't even take a natural disaster. At the sign of an incoming tornado, the stores can be emptied of food and water within a matter of hours, and this is well documented repeatedly in recent history. I guess I don't get a lot of comfort. I don't get as much hope or comfort as he seems to from this thought. We just saw today's news that hundreds of thousands of people are without power just because a single storm rolls through.
These systems are fragile.
Even if, as he's saying, transportation and technology can alleviate these failures, the prices are going to go up, which means we're going to be spending more of our resources on food. So growing food is actually a forward-looking investment of our time. At the very worst, and at the best, it's going to save, you know, our family. And then the last note there that he actually calls out, while he doesn't even agree with Scafetta's models, he is defending him and saying that calling this guy a climate denier is just, it's ridiculous. It's inaccurate, unfair. And it's not altogether surprising to see this kind of defense coming from someone who doesn't agree with him, because for one, agreement isn't required between scientists to respect each other, or for humans in general. I respect plenty of people with whom I don't agree, and I wish more people who disagreed could respect each other. I think we would be having more civil discourse broadly, which is actually very much needed. So that's good to see. But I think also Shirley has definitely been on the receiving end of the climate denier and the political agenda. And if not, it's because he's been pretty wise to constrain his studies recently to Mars. So all in all, it's sort of an interesting message. The paper, the Scafetta 2013 paper, I will share now. I've put it on iceagefarmer.com/docs, named Scafetta ESR13. I will be taking a look at this so we can discuss it in a future episode. I gotta run now and do a bunch of stuff here and get ready for this trip. But take a look at that paper, and you'll note that mostly the predictions, if you want to skip to the good parts, it's a good paper and it's worth reading. Most of the predictions are just straight out to the right. Pretty even, not warming or cooling. And this does account for the solar cycles, as well as a bunch of other planetary dynamics. I will observe now only that the transportation systems that Shirley says should be there in case there are localized agricultural failures are going to have problems if there are seismic activities like those in the previous minima, which would disable our infrastructure and those transportation. So, I don't know, I feel like these are models that are almost over-specified to the solar conditions, to the planetary conditions, and perhaps don't take into consideration the seismic and volcanic effects, and how the climate will then have secondary effects from those. But let's take a look at this and review it in the next episode. And that is all for today's episode of Ice Age Farmer Podcast. I hope you enjoyed the show and got something out of it. Please spread the word about it. As you just heard, we're on Stitcher and iTunes now, as well as here on YouTube. Spread the word about the Grand Solar Minimum and start taking steps every day towards self-sufficiency so that we can all prosper together in the Grand Solar Minimum. Take care.